Good morning, everyone, and welcome to the third meeting for 2021 of the Justice Committee. We have no apologies this morning, and we're joined today by Andy Whiteman, MSP, and by the Minister for Community Safety, Ash Denham, MSP, and I welcome you both to our meeting this morning. Our first agenda item is Stage 2 consideration of the Defamation and Malicious Publications Scotland Bill. So members should have with them a copy of the corrected martial list and the corrected groupings for debate this morning. Before we start, I just want to say that this is a fully virtual meeting and that we will use the chat function on BlueJeans as the means of voting electronically today. When we do vote, I will call for members to type Y in the chat box to record any votes for yes, and then I'll do the same in turn for no, and you'll type N and abstain, typing A. The clerks will collate the results and I will then have to read them out, not only the results, but also the names of who voted in which way. I will identify each member by vote. And if I make a mistake, then please alert me straight away by typing R or mistake or idiot in the chat box. And I will then be able to correct the mistake before we move on. Once we have moved on, as I understand it, we won't be able to go back and correct earlier errors, so no pressure. I will take this as slowly as I can so that we all have time to manage all of this properly. And I would ask, as I always do, members and the Minister to keep contributions as brief as they can and to use always the chat function on BlueJeans to catch my attention if you want to speak by typing R in the usual way. I remind the Minister's officials that they cannot speak during this stage, but they can communicate to the Minister directly. And finally, by way of introduction, I need to say just this, that if we do lose connection with any member or with the Minister at any point, I will suspend the meeting to try to get the member back into the meeting. And if we can't do that after a reasonable time, then the Deputy Convener and I will have to decide how to proceed. If there are any questions, please ask them now. But if there are no questions, then we will make a start. I call Amendment 29 in the name of Andy Whiteman, which is grouped with Amendments 30, 31, 32, and 36. And I would point out that if Amendment 29 is agreed to, I cannot call the other amendments. I cannot call Amendments 30, 31, and 32 due to preemption. So I ask Andy Whiteman to move Amendment 29 and to speak to all amendments in the group. Mr. Whiteman.
Thank you very much, Convener. I move Amendment 29 in my name. In policy terms, all amendments relate to Section 1. In your Stage 1 report, you recommended that the Scottish Government reviews the evidence you heard in relation to the serious harm test and set out a clear statement as to why the serious harm test is still required. Excuse me. I am not persuaded that the Minister has done this in her Stage 1 report response to you. My amendments seek to do three separate things in policy terms. Amendment 29 removes in its entirety the serious harm test and any provisions for any threshold test at all. Amendments 30, 31 and 36 take a different approach. They retain a threshold test, but reduce the threshold from serious to actual harm. And then Amendment 32 stands on its own and provides what I consider to be a more appropriate qualifier to the financial test. Convener, the serious harm test, as the committee is well aware, was introduced to the 2013 Defamation Act in England for reasons that are well known, namely the volume of litigation, the vexatious nature of some of it, but also because there was a muddle in English law as a consequence of the distinct wrongs of slander and libel. A muddle, as I think Dr. Blackie pointed out, in evidence we do not have in Scotland, and other arguments were presented to you by people like Campbell Dean and Duncan Hamilton. Now, the Law Commission did conclude that a threshold was desirable, but actually spent very little time considering at what height the bar should be set. Now, since the introduction of the bill, and as a legislator, I have come to question more and more the justification for a serious harm threshold. And my concern is exacerbated by the fact that the bill introduces a statutory definition of defamation in Section 1.4. And so we are, Convener, in the curious and I would say bizarre position of proposing to enshrine in law a statutory civil wrong, but then in the very same section of the bill, saying that there's nothing you can do about it if you suffer this wrong, unless you can demonstrate that the harm is serious. Who are we as the legislature to tell those we represent that they cannot pursue justice for a statutory civil wrong that we have created? Amendment 29 deals with this very bluntly by removing the serious harm test altogether and leaves Section 1 as a section that simply defines defamation. Moving on, by removing the serious harm test, one also removes any kind of threshold, though, for action ability. And as members know, in an action before a court, harm is currently presumed. It does, of course, have to be proven at proof, but there's no necessity to demonstrate any such harm in order for proceedings to go straight to a full proof with all the attendant costs. The argument for our threshold test, in my view, can be justified as a means of providing reassurance to writers, publishers and broadcasters that they will only be sued for defamation if some evidence of actual harm can be demonstrated to a court in a pre-proof procedure. If it cannot, then there'll be no action. And so as an alternative, therefore, to removing the serious harm threshold in its entirety, I propose in these amendments to replace the word serious with actual. This will necessitate that pursuers can evidence that there has been or is likely to be actual harm caused to the pursuer before any case can proceed. It's an alternative to getting rid of the test altogether that I myself am more comfortable with and would encourage the committee to support. And I propose the replacement of serious by actual for four reasons. One, I don't think there's any justification for a serious harm test. Two, the Supreme Court ruling in Lachaud means that the English threshold test must be tested against the facts and not just the inherent meaning of words. And so replacing serious with actual is consistent with Lachaud. This third, the serious harm threshold conflicts, as I've already argued, with the statutory wrong created in Section 1.4 and may exclude, almost certainly will exclude, perfectly valid complaints. Parliament should not deny citizens recourse to the courts where they've suffered harm that falls short of serious. And finally, and fourthly, more fundamentally, there's a good case for a procedure whereby the current presumption of harm is assessed as to whether it is actually harm at all. Moving on to Amendment 32, this changes the test of serious financial loss in Section 1.3 with a test of significant loss. The reason for this is that the term serious does not sit well, in my view, as an appropriate qualifier for financial loss. Serious for a small company may not be serious for a large one. Significant is more of a proportionate term, reflecting more precisely the relationship between the loss and the size of the organisation and its financial strength. And I would just like to add one more observation on this subsection. It relates to non-natural persons who have as their primary purpose trading for profit. And I would invite the Minister to reflect further on whether community interest companies may or may not have this as their primary purpose are intended to be captured by this definition. I ask because in the case I was involved in as a defender, the pursuer was a community interest company and under the common law had to show patrimonial loss. If some community interest companies do not trade primarily for profit, but they still trade for profit, but not primarily, it looks to me as if they'll be excluded from the scope of bringing any action for defamation, and I'm not sure that's what was intended. Finally, Convener, Amendment 36 amends Section 5. As the explanatory note states, this is designed to replace the materially injure phrase used in the Defamation Act 1952 with the term serious to ensure consistency with Section 1.2b of the bill. Thus, if Amendments 31 and 32 are agreed, then serious should be deleted here, and I do not think it adds anything to add the term actual here, as the threshold test will already have been met by the time defences are being argued at proof and in order to be consistent with the statutory definition in Section 1.3. To conclude, Convener, this section of the bill I do think requires further scrutiny, stress testing and consideration. My amendments are a contribution to that endeavour. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mr. Whiteman. Annabel Ewing has indicated that she'd like to speak in this group. Annabel.
Thank you, Convener. In my contribution to the Stage 1 debate, I asked the Minister to further reflect as to whether the balance struck in the bill as between freedom of expression and the protection of reputation was the right one. And to be fair, I would say that the Minister did just that, for certainly she agreed to meet with me, and I understand that she also met with other MSPs to discuss the matter in more detail. For my part, Convener, I am satisfied that the need to deal adequately with the chilling effect requires an appropriate balancing, as indeed highlighted by many witnesses who gave evidence to the committee. And I would also say that further to my testing of the argument with the Minister, it is clear to me that she had indeed further reflected carefully on the matter and had therefore marshalled her arguments accordingly. And finally, I would say that the Scottish courts have demonstrated their pragmatic approach to procedural matters over many centuries, and I would expect that that approach would persist. Thank you, Convener.
Thank you, Annabel. John Finney has indicated that he'd like to speak in this group. John, please.
Thank you, Convener. I'd just like to make a brief contribution in support of Mr. Whiteman and remind members of one phrase that we frequently have referred to as Convener, and that is the phrase access to justice. It's often a phrase that's abused in communications with our committee, but I thought Mr. Whiteman made a compelling case about the parameters that have been set and the implications that may have for access to justice. Also, a suggestion that, I mean, are we really saying that people would make frivolous claims in this way? I think it's important that the public feel that it's not about status that you gain access to our courts. It's about the rights or wrongs as you perceive it and for others to judge. So for those reasons, I'll be supporting Mr. Whiteman's amendments. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Finney. No other member has indicated that they wish to speak in this group, so I call the Minister, please. Minister.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning to the committee. The threshold test of serious harm is an important reform of the current Scots law of defamation, and it has been the cause of sharply divided opinion amongst stakeholders and, I think, in the Parliament as well. And perhaps this issue, more than others, highlights that delicate balance sought between the two competing rights, so the right to reputation and the right to freedom of expression. And the Scottish Government's view is that where damage to reputation is presumed, as happens currently, the law does not get that balance right. So the committee has heard directly from stakeholders about how they've experienced the chilling effect. They've told the committee that the threshold test is necessary to give them confidence to resist attempts that, in their view, are aimed at stifling their free speech. And if damage to reputation is always presumed, there can be no such confidence. So the courts in Scotland have set out that even in a case where there is found to be minimal damage to an individual's reputation, an award of damages should be of substance. And if more were then added on top of this for presumed damage done to reputation, then any award would likely have serious consequences. Faced with a threat of defamation proceedings, where damage is presumed, even if there is little actual damage, most individuals would probably take the safest option and remove the material complained of. So having a threshold test of serious harm can, in these circumstances, make an important difference. And after all, it seems to me only right that if you say your reputation has been damaged, you should have to show what extent it has been damaged. As an alternative, Amendments 30, 31 and 32 would replace the serious harm test with one of actual harm. And I understand the view is that Scots law should have a threshold test, but it should not be one of serious harm. So the proposed amendments change the test to one of actual harm. However, I think that would set the bar too low. It would mean that any evidence of harm, no matter how little, would be enough to meet the test, and so almost all actions would proceed. Further, these amendments would signal to the courts that Parliament intends something different from the serious harm test, and it would deprive us of the clarity of how courts should treat the threshold test of serious harm that has come with the UK Supreme Court interpretation of Section 1 in England and Wales. And that result is then likely to be a long period of doubt and uncertainty about what the test of actual harm means, which of course is the opposite of certainty in the law, which this bill is trying to achieve. It may also have an effect on what is published here in Scotland. Publication of alleged defamatory material often spills over territorial boundaries. Should the people of Scotland have less protection for free speech than the people of England and Wales? The committee has heard examples of the chilling effect in Scotland. However, having a lower threshold that could easily be breached would not significantly deter this type of behaviour. So Amendments 31 and 32 would have the effect of removing the serious harm test for companies and replacing it with an actual harm test, where significant financial loss must be established. And individuals would therefore need to show actual harm, and companies would need to show significant financial loss. And these amendments would have the effect of treating such persons differently in law. And I'm not sure I understand why that should be the case. After all, not every company is a multinational or a large company with a turnover in the millions. A lot of companies in Scotland are small, some are micro enterprises, and for them, their reputation would, of course, be especially important. On the drafting of Amendment 29, I'd like to point out that the removal of Section 1(1) would reinstate the current rule that proceedings for defamation can be brought even if a statement complained of is conveyed only to the person about whom it is made and not to a third party. I'm not sure if that is the member's intention, but its effect goes beyond the threshold test of serious harm, and the current drafting of Section 1(1) has been welcomed as an important change by a large number of stakeholders. In all, setting the threshold too low could have serious consequences for freedom of expression. It would not give enough confidence to those who wish to defend their freedom of expression in face of a defamation action, while making it only slightly more difficult to protect reputation. And finally, just a minor point on the consequential change made by Amendment 36. Removing the word serious in that section and then failing to replace it would leave a gap in the law, as the policy behind the threshold test is circumvented. So I would ask the member not to press his amendments. Thank you, Convener.
Thank you very much, Minister. I now invite Andy Whiteman to respond and to wind up in this group. Mr. Whiteman.
Thank you, Convener. First of all, I want to follow what Annabel Ewing was saying and acknowledge that, in fact, I had a very productive meeting with the Minister about this topic. But we haven't concluded anything as a consequence of those discussions. I mean, I'm glad the Minister acknowledges that we do need a threshold test, and I think the committee is agreed that we need a threshold test. And a threshold test is useful to counter the chilling effect. So I think the question is, should that test be serious? Now, I would make two points. One is, as the Minister said, there was a stark division in evidence to you on this topic. The Law Commission also was clear that there should be a threshold test, but didn't spend a great deal of time considering whether it was serious. It kind of took that as a default position because that was the position in England. And the Minister also referenced the fact about whether Scots law of defamation should be different in terms of the actionability test from England and Wales. I mean, this is an argument that never made by government ministers and many other things, that we should be entirely consistent. Scots law of defamation should develop and evolve on the basis of its own needs. And that part of that need is people in Scotland, what access to justice they should have. And the reasons for a serious harm threshold being introduced in England are reasons that are absent in Scotland. I mentioned two of them, and you had a few more in your evidence. So I come back to my principal concern here, Convener, which is that we are creating a statutory wrong in Section 1(4)(a), that a statement about a person is defamatory if it causes harm to the person's reputation. And what we're saying is, if that wrong is committed against you, you have no redress. You're unable to bring any action whatsoever unless you can demonstrate, possibly at some cost, that that harm is serious. Now, I do not think that that is good law. I think it is a stark contradiction, internal contradiction in the bill and in Section 1. And I do not think it's fair to the people of Scotland, many of whom do suffer harm as a result of untrue, malicious statements made against them. And I think they're entitled to some redress. And therefore, the purpose of proposing Amendments 30 and 31 is to allow some evidence of actual harm being committed. So in other words, to deal with the problem that people allege exists, which is there's lots of frivolous threats made to people when there's no harm whatsoever. Now, the point is, at the stage which people write legal letters to each other, we don't know, obviously. People can make any allegation they like about harm. So there is a good argument for a threshold test, but in my view, actual is much more appropriate. Now, if we're to continue this argument beyond stage two, if my amendments on actual are in fact dismissed, I will be coming back with a suggestion of maybe significant. I mean, I really do think we need to consider carefully both the justification and the impact of using the term serious, when A, there is little justification for it in Scotland, and B, that it sets up an internal contradiction between creating a statutory wrong and then saying to people, here's your parliament, we've created this wrong, you've suffered it, there's nothing you can do about it. Thank you, convener.
Thank you very much. I take it, Mr. Whiteman, that you're pressing Amendment 29.
I'm not going to press Amendment 29. There's any appetite for that, and the Minister mentioned that it deletes 1-1, which is unhelpful. So I will not press 29.
Okay. I think Amendment 29 has already been moved. So I need to, I think the committee needs to, are members of the committee content for Mr. Whiteman to withdraw Amendment 29? Members are content. I call Amendment 30 in the name of Andy Whiteman, already debated with Amendment 29. Mr. Whiteman, to move or not move?
Moved.
That is moved. So the question is that Amendment 30 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? If members have disagreed, type N in the chat box. Members are not agreed, so we will move to a vote. So all those in favour of Amendment 30 should type Y in the chat box. All those opposed to Amendment 30 should type N in the chat box. And anybody abstaining should type A into the chat box. There were 3 votes in favour. There were 6 votes against. Those voting in favour were John Finney, Rhoda Grant and Liam MacArthur. Those voting against were Rona Mackay, Annabel Ewing, Shona Robinson, Fulton McGregor, Adam Tompkins and Liam Kerr. So the amendment is not agreed to. I call Amendment 31 in the name of Mr. Whiteman, already debated with Amendment 29. And Mr. Whiteman, to move or not move?
Not moved.
That is not moved. I call Amendment 32 in the name of Mr. Whiteman, already debated with Amendment 29. Mr. Whiteman, to move or not move?
Moved.
That is moved. The question is that Amendment 32 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? My chat box is not refreshing. We are not agreed. So members in favour of Amendment 32 should type Y into the chat box now. Members opposed to Amendment 32 should type N into the chat box now. And members abstaining on Amendment 32 should type A into the chat box now. There were 3 votes in favour of Amendment 32 and 6 votes against. Those voting in favour were John Finney, Rhoda Grant and Liam MacArthur. Those voting against were Annabel Ewing, Rona Mackay, Fulton McGregor, Shona Robinson, Liam Kerr and Adam Tompkins. The amendment is not agreed to. We move to the next group, which concerns prohibition on public authorities bringing proceedings, which is section 2 of the bill. I call Amendment 1 in the name of the Minister, grouped with Amendments 33, 2, 3, 34, 4 and 35. And I point out that if Amendment 33 is agreed to, I cannot call Amendment 2 due to preemption. Minister, to move Amendment 1 and speak to all amendments in the group. Minister, please.
Thank you. Section 2 aims to place on a statutory footing the common law principle that public authorities cannot raise defamation proceedings. Public authorities have a reputation, but they need to protect it using political means and not defamation law. The public interest is best served by allowing unrestrained comment on the actions of democratically elected bodies. And this is the fundamental rationale behind the Derbyshire principle. While it's accepted that this is an important principle and that it should be codified in the bill, The committee recommended that the section be redrafted to make it clearer the Scottish Government's intention, and these four amendments, I believe, do that. So the Scottish Government has been clear about what it considers to be caught by the Derbyshire principle, and so these amendments seek to insert an expanded description of what constitutes a public authority. The types of bodies that should be caught by the principle are the various forms of local government and central government institutions, and include those institutions that they own or control. Court or tribunal is also included. The section retains the catch-all definition of what constitutes a public authority at subsection 2D. Defamation law is very sensitive to the facts of individual cases, and public service delivery has changed significantly over the past two decades and continues to do so. Having this catch-all definition will provide needed flexibility for ensuring that all public authorities that should protect their reputation at the ballot box do so. The Scottish Government considered that listing all the specific bodies prohibited from raising defamation proceedings would, in the long run, be too restrictive. And as I have said, models of public service delivery may change, new bodies are created, owned and controlled. So to have a list on the face of the bill would make it challenging, I think, to keep up to date all those changes, and it would not allow the law to develop in a satisfactory way. And it may be that some governmental institutions that should be prohibited are not, because they haven't been added to the list. So I will nonetheless commit to providing a number of specific examples of the bodies that the Scottish Government consider to be prohibited in the explanatory notes. The bill as introduced allows Scottish ministers to specify persons who are not to be treated as a public authority, and the amendment to subsection 6 would allow Scottish ministers to specify persons who are to be considered a public authority. And the power is to be subject to the affirmative procedure after consultation. And this amendment would add flexibility for dealing with marginal cases or where there are changes to public service delivery that justify a different approach. And this is a sensible and a proportionate power to take if the narrow list of the types of institutions to be prohibited is adopted. So two minor amendments are made to subsection 4 and 5. The first reflects that there is now more than one reference in this section to ownership and control. And the second clarifies that in addition to an office holder, employees can raise defamation proceedings in their own name. And that latter issue was raised by some stakeholders during stage one, and the Scottish Government decided that it was best to put this matter beyond doubt. On amendments 34, 33 and 35, John Finney has said that the Derbyshire principle, which section 2 codifies, should be wider than prohibiting governmental bodies from raising defamation proceedings. Private companies and charities delivering public services should also be prohibited, but the Scottish Government don't agree with that approach. The public authority has the ability to protect its reputation at the ballot box, and a private company is able to protect its reputation by raising defamation proceedings where its reputation has been unfairly damaged. And this right is recognised by our courts and by the European Court of Human Rights. If Amendment 33 were passed, then a private company or charity that delivers public services would no longer be able to protect its reputation. It would not have access to the courts, and it would not have the ballot box. How then could such a company remedy false and damaging statements that are published about it? It's not right to, on the one hand, strip a private company of its right to raise defamation proceedings without at the same time providing it with an alternative way to protect its reputation. So this does not achieve the necessary balance between protection of reputation and freedom of expression that the bill tries to seek overall. And it's hard to understand why two private companies should have different rights based solely on who they sell services to. The bill does, on the other hand, make a number of important changes that will allow individuals to rightly and fairly criticise the delivery of public services, even when provided by a private company or a charity. And it does that while continuing to allow these same companies or charities to protect their reputation where necessary. Amendment 33, in removing subsections 3 and 4, removes the presumption that bodies that exercise public functions sporadically are not to be considered a public authority. And use of the words "from time to time" is intended to reflect the fact that such entities may operate on a contractual basis, but does not preclude the possibility of them being found to be public authorities. Instead, finding may not be made solely on the basis of their carrying out functions of a public nature from time to time. With this presumption removed, anyone who contracts with a public authority risks being considered a public authority. So any company, large or small, any small charity or so on. So given the importance of reputation to those type of businesses or other operations, would they continue to contract to deliver these services? Would they price such risk into their contracts with local or central government? And this, of course, may have a financial impact on local authorities. Even with the amendments proposed, it's possible that the courts may interpret this section narrowly and exclude these bodies anyway. And this would be in line with the decisions of the courts to date in relation to what constitutes a public authority under the Human Rights Act. And also because the section is supposed to be codifying the Derbyshire principle, which is, of course, primarily concerned with government bodies. And as we're all aware, this would mean it's unlikely that private companies would be included as they're not governmental bodies, even where they occasionally exercise a public function. And finally, the drafting of Amendment 34 and 35 creates an anomaly. As amended, the regulation making power leaves it open to Scottish ministers to exclude governmental bodies and companies owned by government, but not private companies owned by the government. So that seems to create entirely the wrong impression given the underlying purpose of the provision. So I move Amendment 1, Convener, and I encourage members to support my other amendments in this group.
Thank you very much, Minister. I invite John Finney to speak to Amendment 33 and the other amendments in the group. And after John Finney, it will be Rhoda Grant. John.
Very much. What we do know is that the rationale for the Law Lords decision about the Derbyshire principle was that the public body should be open to, and I quote here, uninhibited public criticism, and that reputation should be protected by political rather than legal means. And I pose the question, what is it that public bodies should face uninhibited criticism about? It is the delivery of services, performance that extends to which they effectively serve our citizens. A number of bodies presently delivering public service in Scotland do have a statutory obligation, that is to serve their shareholders. And is it reasonable that uninhibited public criticism should cease just because a function is outsourced? The issue of time to time was touched on by the Minister, and I'm going to come back to that shortly. We heard from a number of people on this issue. Dr. Andrew Patel talked about something that I thought many members would warm to, and that was following the public pound about how they deliver public services. We heard from the Guardian News and Media Group that there'd be, and I quote here, considerable public interest in creating an environment in which people are able to criticise and scrutinise the actions of for-profit corporations. And we also have some concerns about the issue that the Minister alluded to, the efforts made to circumvent some of it by initiating proceedings in a person's name. The Minister for Community Safety said in our response that we need to ensure we take a flexible approach so that courts can deal with complex and nuanced cases as things develop. PFI PPP contracts depending on the project, or let me say the level of racketeering, and I can't say that, typically last 25 to 30 years, some even more than 40 years, and have huge implications for our public services, for schools and hospital. The current sleeper contract awarded to Serco is a 15-year contract. The Scottish Prison Service has 13 publicly managed prisons and two run by private operators, Serco and Sodexo. Electronic monitoring of people in home detention, curfew and other things is undertaken by G4S. Our ferries, significant public money, and it would seem that CalMac, who provides the routes in the Clyde and Hebrides routes, are afforded a different approach to the Serco, who provide, and there's a name that keeps recurring, the Northern Isles ferry system. I particularly want to talk about the issue that one of our witnesses alluded to in relation to North Lanarkshire, and that's a particular constituency case I had, and it was about the delivery of care at home services, where the provider initially was a private company and there was insufficient capacity within the private company to provide the level of care that was required, that was therefore supplemented by a role for the local authority. Isn't it ironic that there's a different approach that would be taken in with regard to the totality of care provided to that individual? It was Lord Keith of Kinkale that outlined in his judgment, it's the highest public importance that democratically governed body could be open to uninhibited criticism. And if we look at the PPP PFI and the reputation of companies in the role in the public sector, where is that check and balance of dealing with administrations will come and go, several administrations will come and go over the course of these inquiries? The idea that what does remain in the bill, of course, is subsection 1, which is the definition of public authority. And what we didn't hear from the minister was any, and the devil is always in the detail, any detail about subsection 6. So if the minister could allude to that in her summing up, that would be helpful. This isn't an ideological debate on the merits or otherwise of outsourcing public services. I think my views in that are very clearly understood. This is about our important scrutiny function. Administrations can come and go, as I say, and a 15-year-old contract that many administrations might oversee, that's a long time to give added protection to the company. All of them, which are more than capable of looking after themselves, that provide that important public service. Parliamentarians have legal privileges. We are privileged. It would be a source of real regret if we didn't extend that right of uninhibited public criticism of the providers of public services to our fellow citizens. And I'll leave it there. Thank you, Convener.
Thank you very much, Mr. Finney. I call Rhoda Grant, please.
Thank you, Convener. I just want to speak in support of John Finney's amendments. I think it is really important where a company or organisation is carrying out a public service that they are scrutinised properly and that there is no chilling effect, because quite often when we look at how public services are delivered by private companies, they are failing. I mean, take for example, recently, the issue with meal tax for young people, where they were absolutely inadequate. But if that company were able to sue, that could be an issue of bringing that into the public debate and criticising it. So it's very important where the public pound is, then there shouldn't be a chilling effect as to criticising it. So I support John Finney's amendments.
Thank you, Rhoda. No other member has indicated that they wish to speak in this group. So could I ask the Minister to respond to what she said and to wind up, please?
Thank you, Convener. So obviously most of that discussion was about this right to criticise the delivery of public services. And I think that is a really important right that I believe the bill already takes seriously. So I think the way that we've approached this and the policy intention of the bill is to make sure that that is possible. So the bill already makes a number of changes which, when you take them in combination, strongly protect that freedom to criticise delivery of public services. So you've got the serious harm test, you've got the reformed defence of honest opinion, and the new defence of publication on a matter of public interest. And they all work together to ensure that we protect the ability of individuals to freely criticise the private delivery of public services. And companies would then have to show that a defamatory statement caused serious financial loss, and I believe the committee has heard that this is not an easy thing to prove. The reformed defence of honest opinion will widen the defence to include facts that a person reasonably believed to be true. And Dr. Scott told the committee that this is an innovative and it hasn't been done anywhere else, and it will help Scottish law to move away from that surfeit of technicality in this area of the law. So those new defences of publication in a matter of public interest, and they will protect the individual's ability to criticise public services. I want individuals to be openly able to discuss matters of public importance and of significance. And I believe that the reforms that I've put forward in the bill will, taken together, give the necessary protections to do this. But I believe that John Finney's amendments, whilst well-intentioned, do not And I think they go way beyond this codification of the Derbyshire principle, which we are trying to that we're trying to do here. Thanks, Convener.
Thank you very much, Minister. And before I put Amendment 1 to the vote, that's the first amendment in this group, I need first to ask that Section 1 of the bill be agreed to. I should have put that question before we started this group, I apologise. So can I ask that Section 1 of the bill be agreed to? Are we all agreed? We are all agreed. Thank you. So I now put the question that Amendment 1 be agreed to. That's the first of the amendments in the group that we've just debated. So the question is that Amendment 1 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? We're not agreed. We'll move to a vote. The members in favour of Amendment 1 should type Y into the chat box now. Members who disagree with Amendment 1 should type N into the chat box now. And any member abstaining with regard to Amendment 1 should type A into the chat box now. Can I see a result, please, Clark? So the result on Amendment 1 is yes, 7, no, 2. There were no abstentions. Those voting in favour of the amendment were Adam Tomkins, Liam Kerr, Annabelle Ewing, Rona Mackay, Liam MacArthur, Shona Robertson, and Fulton McGregor. Those voting against were John Finney and Rona Grant. Sorry for the hesitation, but the reason for the hesitation was that Liam Kerr voted twice. So I had 8 votes in favour, but only one of Liam Kerr's votes counted in favour. That's why I couldn't quite figure out what was going on there, but the result is that Amendment 1 is not agreed to. And I'll call Amendment 33 in the name of John Finney, already debated with Amendment 1. John Finney, to move or not move?
Move, Convener.
Thank you, Mr. Finney. That is moved. So the question is that Amendment 33 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? We're not agreed, so we will move to a vote. Members in favour of Amendment 33 should type Y into the chat box now. Members who disagree with Amendment 33 should type N into the chat box now. There were 2 votes in favour, there were 7 votes against. Those voting in favour were John Finney and Rhoda Grant. Those voting against were Rona Mackay, Annabelle Ewing, Shona Robertson, Fulton McGregor, Adam Tomkins, Liam Kerr, and Liam MacArthur. Please correct me if I've got that wrong. So the amendment is not agreed. I call Amendment 2 in the name of the Minister, already debated with Amendment 1. Minister, to move formally.
Moved, Convener.
Thank you, Minister. The question is that Amendment 2 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? We're not agreed. There'll be a vote. So members who are in favour of Amendment 2 should type Y into the chat box now. Members who disagree with Amendment 2 should type N into the chat box now. And any member abstaining should type A into the chat box now. There were 7 votes in favour, there were 2 votes against. Those voting in favour were Rona Mackay, Annabelle Ewing, Shona Robertson, Fulton McGregor, Adam Tomkins, Liam Kerr and Liam MacArthur. Those voting against were Rhoda Grant and John Finney. The amendment is agreed to. I call Amendment 3 in the name of the Minister, already debated with Amendment 1. Minister, to move formally. Sorry, Minister, can you do that again with your microphone on this time?
Moved, Convener.
Thank you. That is moved. The question is that Amendment 3 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? We're not agreed. There will be a vote. All those members in favour of Amendment 3 should type Y into the chat box now. All those members opposed to Amendment 3 should type N into the chat box now. Any member abstaining should type A into the chat box now. There were 8 votes in favour. There was 1 vote against. Those voting in favour were Rona Mackay, Annabelle Ewing, Shona Robertson, Fulton McGregor, Adam Tompkins, Liam Kerr, Rhoda Grant, and Liam MacArthur. And John Finney voted against. The amendment is agreed. I call Amendment 34 in the name of John Finney, already debated with Amendment 1. John Finney to move or not move, please.
Move, Convener.
Thank you, Mr. Finney. That is moved. The question is that Amendment 34 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? We're not agreed. There will be a vote. So all those members in favour of Amendment 34, please type Y into the chat box now. All those members opposed to Amendment 34, please type N into the chat box now. And any member abstaining, please type A into the chat box. There were 7 votes, sorry, there were 2 votes in favour, there were 7 votes against. Those voting in favour were John Finney and Rhoda Grant. Those voting against were Adam Tompkins, Shona Robertson, Annabelle Ewing, Liam Kerr, Fulton McGregor, Liam MacArthur, Rona Mackay. The amendment is not agreed. I call Amendment 4 in the name of the Minister, already debated with Amendment 1. Minister to move formally, please.
Moved, Convener.
Thank you, Minister. The question is that Amendment 4 be agreed. Are we all agreed? We are agreed. Are we not agreed? No, we're not, sorry. The question, we're not agreed on Amendment 4, so we will... We're not agreed on Amendment 4, so we will move to a vote on Amendment 4. All those in favour of Amendment 4, please type Y into the chat box now. All those opposed to Amendment 4, please type N into the chat box now. Any member abstaining, please type A into the chat box now. There were 7 votes in favour, there were 2 votes against. Those voting in favour were Rona Mackay, Annabelle Ewing, Shona Robertson, Fulton McGregor, Adam Tompkins, Liam Kerr, Liam MacArthur. Those voting against were John Finney and Rhoda Grant. The amendment is agreed to. I call Amendment 35 in the name of Mr. Finney, already debated with Amendment 1. Mr. Finney to move or not move?
Not move, Convener. Thank you.
That is not moved. Thank you, Mr. Finney. The question is that Section 2 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? We are agreed. We move to the next group, which is on secondary publishers. I call Amendment 5 in the name of the Minister, grouped with Amendments 6, 7 and 37. Minister to move Amendment 5 and to speak to all amendments in the group. Minister.
Thank you, Convener. Section 3 is intended to limit the circumstances in which a defamation action can be brought against a secondary publisher. And in short, someone who is not the author, editor or primary publisher of an allegedly defamatory statement should not be capable of being sued, except to the extent that they are responsible for a statement's content or their decision to publish it. Subsections 3, 4 and 5 set out a number of situations where a person is not to be considered an author, editor or a publisher. These protections are equally intended for employee or agent of a secondary publisher in the same situation if they're not responsible for the content or the decision to publish the statement that is complained of. And this is similar to the current legal position as provided for in Section 1 of the Defamation Act of 1996. However, some doubt has arisen as to whether the drafting of Section 3 adequately carries these protections over into the bill. For instance, subsection 4 isn't framed in terms of being about when someone is or isn't responsible for the statement's content or the decision to publish it. It's framed as being about whether a person is to be considered the author, editor, or publisher. And so it may not help answer the question of whether an employee or an agent is responsible for the content or the statement or the decision to publish it. So in order to address this, amendments 5, 6, and 7 expressly deal with a position in subsections 3 to 5, and for the avoidance of doubt, make it clear that an employee or agent would, just like their employer or principal, not be liable in situations outlined in the subsections if the activity described is the only involvement they have with the statement. On Amendment 37, I do understand the wariness of stakeholders for Scottish ministers to have this regulation-making power. However, as the Scottish Government have made clear in the Delegated Powers Memorandum that accompanies the bill, the reason for taking this power was to enable Scottish ministers to future-proof the bill, if you like. So as this bill has progressed, I've tried to express a preference to have as much of the law of defamation as possible on the face of the bill, rather than by regulations or by court rules. So in Section 3, the drafting has largely replicated a similar provision in the Defamation Act of 1996. Who could have predicted the changes that social media has brought to us since then? So while I think there is some merit in leaving this provision in its current form, so as to be able to address what the future may bring, I'm reasonably confident that it will likely only be technological developments and changes in the use of technology for dissemination of materials and information that would prompt Scottish ministers to want to revisit this provision. But I am concerned that the drafting of Amendment 37 doesn't significantly take into account the fact that not all changes in the use of technology for the dissemination of material will be the direct result of technological developments. So there may be cases where technology already developed is repurposed or so on. So the result may be that those who need protection would have to wait longer for primary legislation in order to provide it. So I would ask Mr. Kerr, if he was so minded, not to press his amendment at this stage and instead work with the Scottish Government to ensure that the power of ministers is restricted to reflect technological developments or changes in the use of technology for dissemination of materials and information. So I move Amendment 5. I'd encourage members to support the other amendments in my name, and I'd ask Mr. Kerr to consider not pressing his amendments and work with the Scottish Government to develop it further.
Thank you very much, Minister. I call Liam Kerr to speak to Amendment 37 and other amendments in the group. Mr. Kerr.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning to the committee and the Minister. I'll just speak to my Amendment 37. Which was a very specific amendment suggested by the Law Society of Scotland. And as ever, for completeness, I remind members that I am a member of the Law Society of Scotland. The purpose underlying that amendment is to limit the delegated powers of the ministers to technical amendments, whilst allowing the flexibility that the minister just talked about to modernise the law in line with technological developments. Now, to explain what I mean by that, the powers to modify subsections 3.3 and 3.4 under the delegated powers in section 3.6 are at the moment, as drafted, very wide. Now, of course, it makes sense to have that provision. Just like the Minister said, you need a provision that where changes are needed to take account of technological developments, they can be done easily and quickly. And it makes sense to preserve a power to clarify the application of this bill to a particular set of circumstances or where amendments needed to reflect innovation. And that does require to be done easily by regulation. However, it also makes sense to limit that regulation making power to only such situations in order to allow the law to be modernised in line with current principles, but without granting Scottish ministers inappropriately wide powers. So that's what I'm seeking to do here. Basically restrict the ability to amend those situations which merit it. Now, I've listened carefully to the Minister there, and I'd be interested to hear the committee's thoughts on this, because the Minister obviously makes interesting points, but I would like to hear the committee's thoughts on this. And in closing here, whether if the minister is so confident that these changes will be needed, or that these will be limited to technological innovation, then why not let say that simply on the face of the bill? So I'd like to listen to the debate. I'd like to listen to contributions, and then, convener, I shall decide whether to press when you ask me the question later.
Thank you, Mr. Kerr. No member has indicated that they wish to contribute to the debate in this group. So I will pass back to the minister to wind up, respond to what she said, and minister.
Thank you, convener. So the powers that the Scottish Government wants to take are just to future-proof the bill in order to take into account future technological developments. I accept Mr. Kerr's amendments, or the principle of his amendments, shall we say. I just would like to work with him to make a slight edit to them in order to be satisfied that they do exactly what we want them to do and go no further. So I would be happy to accept them with slight edits. So I was hoping that he would not press them at this stage, allow us to work together on them just to slightly edit them and bring them back again at stage three. But I do accept the principle of what he's trying to achieve there.
Thank you, Minister. That's very clear and helpful. So the question is that Amendment 5 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? We are agreed. The question is that Amendment 6 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? We are agreed. The question is that Amendment 7 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? We are agreed. And I call Amendment 37 in the name of Liam Kerr. Already debated with Amendment 5. Liam Kerr, to move or not move?
Thank you, convener. In light of the minister's comments, I have to say, actually, at this stage, the minister has worked very closely, certainly with me, and I think with the rest of the committee on this. And I listen to what she says. I take that in good faith, and I look forward to working with her as we go forward. So on that basis, I shall not press Amendment 37.
Amendment 37 is not moved. The question is that Section 3 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? We are agreed. The question is that Section 4 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? We are agreed. I call Amendment 36 in the name of Andy Whiteman, already debated with Amendment 29. Andy Whiteman, if he's still with us, to move or not move, or John Finney to do it on his behalf if Mr. Whiteman has had to leave.
Convener, Mr. Whiteman's double booked. He has another committee meeting. I said I would move this amendment on his behalf. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Finney. That is moved on Mr. Whiteman's behalf. So the question is that Amendment 36 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? We're not agreed. There will be a division. So all those in favour of Amendment 36 should type Y into the chat box now. All those opposed to Amendment 36 should type N into the chat box now. Any member abstaining on Amendment 36 should type A into the chat box now. There were 3 votes in favour, there were 6 votes against. Those voting in favour were John Finney, Rhoda Grant and Liam MacArthur. Those voting against were Annabel Ewing, Fulton McGregor, Liam Kerr, Adam Tompkins, Rona Mackay and Shona Robeson. So the amendment is not agreed. The question is that Section 5 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? We are agreed. The question is that Sections 6 to 11 and the schedule and Sections 12 and 13 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? We are agreed. We now move to the next group, which concerns offer to make amends, amount of court awarded compensation. I call Amendment 8 in the name of the Minister in a group of its own. Minister to move and speak to the amendment. Minister.
The offer of amends is a helpful way for a publisher who admits that they've published a defamatory statement to apologise and correct the record. In some instances, an offer of compensation is also made, and this avoids the need for costly legal proceedings, and the quick resolution can help to restore an individual's reputation. The sections in the bill that deal with the offer of amends are intended to restate the procedure, not to change it, except for one minor procedural alteration. evidence to the committee cast some doubt on the court's ability to vary an offer of compensation, and some evidence suggested that this aspect of the offer has not changed and that a court could vary an offer. But other evidence suggested that the drafting excluded this possibility. So the committee recommended that the Scottish Government clarify the position and put it beyond doubt. So this amendment does that. It states explicitly, just like the Defamation Act of 1996, that a court is able to vary an offer of compensation by increasing or decreasing the amount to be paid in compensation from that offered. And so I move Amendment 8, Convener. Thank you.
Thank you, Minister. No member has indicated that they wish to speak in this group. So, Minister, do you have anything to add? Minister has nothing to add. So the question is that Amendment 8 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? We are agreed. The question is that Section 14 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? We are agreed. The question is that Sections 15 to 18 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? We are agreed. We move to the next group, which concerns changes required as a result of EU exit, jurisdiction and information society services. And I call Amendment 9 in the name of the Minister, which is grouped with Amendments 10, 11, 12 and 28. Minister, to move Amendment 9 and to speak to all amendments in the group. Minister.
So the matter of civil jurisdiction has been given a great deal of attention because of the UK's withdrawal from the European Union and the subsequent trade agreement. So these changes and the uncertainty surrounding them meant that drafting the jurisdictional rules in this bill were always going to be challenging. Rather than trying to second guess the outcome of the withdrawal agreement and trade negotiations or to take wide powers for Scottish ministers, the Scottish Government has instead opted to legislate for the legal position at that time. So the position is now clearer. And so now these amendments make the necessary adjustments to take into account the legal position as it stands today. References in Section 19 to the EU included associated terminology such as Member State, Brussels Regulation and the Lugano Convention are removed in this section 9 to 12 as the UK is no longer a Member State or signed to the Lugano Convention in its own right. And if these deletions are made, then the jurisdictional rules limiting the circumstances in which an action for defamation may be competently be brought in a court in Scotland are to be found under the Civil Jurisdiction and Judgments Act of 1982. I point out the UK has applied to accede to the 2007 Lugano Convention as an independent contracting member, and the outcome of that application is pending. Once acceded to, this would have implications for jurisdiction in defamation actions, and if and when the UK accedes, however, the Scottish Government intends to use powers in Section 2 of the Private International Law Implementation of Agreements Act 2020 to make regulations for these purposes. So there is therefore no longer a requirement to make separate specific provision in this bill for regulation making powers. In terms of Section 34, it also reflects the legal position at the time the bill was introduced to the Scottish Parliament. Section 34 would have allowed Scottish ministers to make regulations on how providers of information society services were to be treated both in proceedings for defamation and for malicious publication under Part 2 of the bill. And these regulations would have to have been used to implement the provisions of the EU Electronic Commerce Directive into the bill, had the UK not withdrawn from the EU at the end of January 2020. So this regulation power is no longer required. And the bill provides protection to secondary publishers in Section 3 akin to those in the directive and indeed goes further. Therefore, this Amendment 28 deletes Section 34 of the bill. So accordingly, I move Amendment 9 and I ask members to support the other amendments in my name in this group. Thank you, Convener.
Thank you, Minister. No member has indicated that they wish to speak in this group. So, Minister, anything to add? Nothing to add. So the question is, thank you, Minister. The question is that Amendment 9 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? We are agreed. I call Amendments 10, 11 and 12 all in the name of the Minister and all previously debated. And I invite the Minister to move Amendments 10 to 12 en bloc. Those are moved en bloc. Does any member object to a single question being put on Amendments 10 to 12? So the question is, the member objects. So the question is that amendments 10 to 12 are agreed to. Are we all agreed? We are agreed. The question is that section 19 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? We are agreed. The question is that section 20 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? We are agreed. So we move to the next group, which is, I think, the biggest group that we have today, which concerns malicious publication. And I call Amendment 13 in the name of Liam Kerr, grouped with Amendments 14 to 25. Liam Kerr to move Amendment 13 and to speak to all amendments in the group. Mr. Kerr.
Thank you again, Convener. I'll deal with my amendments slightly out of order. Amendments 13 and 25 are basically probing amendments to align the law on malicious publications with that for defamation. Now, a number of witnesses to the committee felt that this should be explored, so that's what I'm seeking to do here. Amendment 13 basically imports the serious harm test from Section 1 into the malicious publications part. So it largely mirrors the approach in Section 1 with some minor alterations to reflect the context of malicious publications. In effect, it requires the statement to be published other than to the offended person and that serious harm has been caused. Now, what's going on here is something that I expressed throughout the committee sessions, that I have a concern that the wrong of malicious publication is a sufficiently lower bar than that of defamation to encourage potential litigants to simply switch their action from what would have been one for defamation to malicious publication. Now, I don't think that can have been the intention of the legislation, and my amendment seeks to ensure that that will not come to pass. Amendment 25, in my name, also seeks to pick up on matters which came out in the committee by making clear that such defences as are applicable are also applicable to malicious publication. I seem to recall that when I pressed on this in the committee sessions, it was the Minister's view that such defences would apply and that she would make that clear in the explanatory notes. Now, I recall that because I thought that doesn't quite stack up with my reading of the bill on the current drafting. If that is right, if the defences do apply without anything in the bill, then I don't think the explanatory notes would provide sufficient comfort given that inherent ambiguity. But if the defences do not apply, then that needs to be explicit. So the amendment as drafted seeks to ensure that the defences in relation to defamation will also apply to malicious publication. And in terms of my drafting, rather than repeating the provisions in the malicious publication part, the amendment simply provides a new section which sets out the defences in section 5 to 7 apply in the malicious publications part. I think, given the ambiguity, therefore, it's important that the government's view on this is expressed and on the record, and hence my reason for proposing those two today. Now, separate point is being made by Amendments 23 and 24. These amendments seek to put some kind of de minimis on the degree of financial loss which is required to be shown for an action. At present, Section 24 simply requires that a statement is more likely than not to cause such loss, with no actual loss being required. And, Kavina, you recall in the committee sessions, I was quite concerned about this because my feeling is that this goes back to the low threshold for a cause of action under malicious publication, and I don't think that's particularly desirable. So what I've tried to do is bring two amendments that in combination gives the courts the power by an act of cederant to set a minimum level of loss to a pursuer before proceedings can be brought. Now, the Minister sent me, as I said, the Minister has been very helpful in trying to work with the, well, certainly me and I suspect the rest of the committee throughout this. And she sent me a letter explaining her position on this. And she said that by operation of law, the principle of de minimis would apply, which of course is true. But I'm all for certainty, and thus I prefer to offer the committee the option for the courts to set a level, not least because earlier on today, of course, I heard the Minister respond to Andy Whiteman's amendments. And if he's right that we need to be clear on the level of harm, then what better way to do it than to specify? Now, of course, I've actually wound back a bit here, as I think one would typically expect such a threshold for financial loss to be set by government or parliamentary process rather than by the court of session, such as, by way of example, the jurisdiction threshold set in Section 39 of the Court Reform Scotland Act of 2014. So I hope my amendment will be considered a reasonable meeting halfway by the committee, and I'd be very interested to hear the committee and the minister's thoughts on these.
Thank you, Mr. Kerr. I ask the minister to speak to Amendment 14 and other amendments in the group. Minister.
Thank you, convener. And I'd like to ask the committee to bear with me here because it's a fairly long explanation, I think, is required on some of these points. So the Scottish Law Commission gave a great deal of consideration to the overall issue of verbal injury, which I think I said when I appeared in front of the committee previously, and the new statutory cause of action of malicious publication. And the definition of malice that it came up with reflects the common law position that it is the legal test that the Scottish Government took forward when the bill was introduced. So the committee heard evidence that the legal test in the bill was too low a threshold in its stage one report and called for the test to be strengthened. In particular, the evidence of Professors Blackie and Reid was that the bill's definition of malice removed the traditional requirement of design to injure. So I understand the committee's concern that without these amendments, companies that operate for profit may use a malicious publication action to circumvent the increased protections for freedom of expression brought about by part one of the bill. Given the strength of the committee's view on this matter and also the evidence that it received, the Scottish Government committed to bringing forward these amendments to adjust the legal test, and the Scottish Government's amendments, that's numbers 14 to 22, address that. In the bill as introduced, the legal test of malice is met when the pursuer proves that either the imputation complained of was presented as a statement of facts and either that the person who made the statement knew it was false or was indifferent to its truth, or that the publication was motivated by a malicious intention to cause harm to the person's business or their business activities. So these amendments will alter that test. The pursuer would now have to prove that the imputation complained of was presented as a statement of fact and that the person who made the statement knew it was false or was recklessly indifferent to its truth, and that the publication was motivated by a malicious intention to cause harm to the person's business or business activities. So adding that word recklessly also raises the bar in line with the committee's concerns. And without this, mere negligence would be enough to fulfil this part of the test. Instead, in line with the committee's concerns, in order to meet the strengthened test, a pursuer must show that a defender made a false statement or clearly did not care about whether it was true or not, and in addition, show that the pursuer had a desire to cause harm. So turning now to Mr. Kerr's amendments. So the two delicts of defamation and malicious publication are distinct, and the law does treat them differently. The balance in each should be based on the features that are unique to it. The serious harm threshold test is needed in the law of defamation because the law makes a number of presumptions that are favourable to the pursuer. And these are that a defamatory statement is false and is made with malice. And currently, the law also presumes damage to reputation, but the serious harm test provides that any such damage will need to be proved in the relevant circumstances. And that, I think, creates the appropriate balance between the two presumptions, benefiting the pursuer, and the serious harm test, which benefits the defender. So the situation in malicious publication is different. So as it stands, the pursuer no longer benefits from the presumption as to falsity and malice, but instead, defenders benefit from the requirement of the pursuer to prove all three of falsity, malice, and also financial loss, adding even further burden to pursuers in malicious publication proceedings by way of this amendment would, in my view, create an inappropriate balance between the burdens between the pursuers and the defenders. So just to give an example, because I know this is quite complicated. If an individual said of a company that its staff or owners were incompetent, aggressive and unpleasant, then in order to establish proceedings of malicious publication, the company would have to prove that the statement was false, that it was made with malice, that the test of which the Scottish Government has brought forward amendments to strengthen, that it caused financial loss. And so taken all together, these are serious hurdles that the pursuer bears the burden of proof for. So if it were a defamation action, then the burden would be on the defender, and that is the person who made the statement complained of. So to then add, as Mr. Kerr suggests, that the hurdle should be set even higher would mean, I think, that it would be then near impossible for a pursuer to raise a successful action. And we should bear in mind why the Scottish Law Commission thought that malicious publication proceedings were necessary. So they said they fill gaps that would be left open if they were removed and defamation was left as the only actionable form of wrong. And so the effect of this amendment would very likely be that persons would be left without any legal remedy for unfair damage done to them. If it is Mr. Kerr's intention to introduce malicious publication, something similar to the threshold test of serious harm in defamation proceedings, then I would ask him to consider the effect of the amendment's drafting on the law of malicious publication. In copying section one of the bill, the member is importing legal concepts that are suited to the law of defamation into a different delict. So on amendments 23 and 24, the member seeks to allow the court of session to set a minimum level of financial loss below which an action in malicious publication cannot be brought. And to this, I point out that companies, again, vary in size and turnover from a small family business to a huge conglomerate. And so having a single minimum amount would be unlikely to account for those differences. And it doesn't seem to me appropriate that something so important, which affects the limits of free speech, should be left to rules of court. And this is something that should and must be debated and decided on by this Parliament. On Amendment 25, as I've already said, the bill deals with two distinct delicts, defamation and malicious publication, and the law treats these two very differently. And the contrast between the two may have given the impression that the Scottish Government has given defamation more consideration than malicious publication. The idea that the defences to a defamation action as laid out in part one of the bill should be repeated for a malicious publication action in part two may have contributed to that impression. The two delicts are different in nature and the law presumes different things. And it is because of these different presumptions that the law of defamation needs those defences, while the law of malicious publication does not. So in defamation, when a statement complained of is determined to be defamatory, the law presumes the statement complained of it is false, that it was a statement of fact, and that it was made with malice. So the law of defamation needs robust defences so the defender can prove why a statement might not be defamatory. In malicious publication, however, the law does not presume these elements. That is reflected in the wording of the new statutory delicts. Instead, it is for the pursuer to prove that the statement complained of is one of facts and not the defender. And accordingly, there's no need for defences in relation of these matters. The onus here is on the pursuer rather than the defender. And as a consequence of that, it's open to the defender to dispute any proof the pursuer may offer. And the Scottish Government has clarified this in the explanatory notes to the bill, and the committee has had sight of these in advance of this session. And I'd finally like to say to Mr. Kerr that even if he were not persuaded by this and he was minded to press his amendment, he'd be introducing defences that are developed over a great deal of time in one branch of the law into another, with all the unintended consequences that that may cause. The courts would be bound to try to find meaning in an introduction of such defences, and it's not at all clear how they would do so in the present circumstances. This is not a change that should be made without further research or consultation. Any statutory defences should be adapted to reflect the new codified versions of malicious publication delicts. And I think it's particularly telling the Scottish Law Commission didn't feel the need to do this as part of their wide-ranging reform. And so I'd ask Mr. Kerr not to press his amendments, but I would ask members to support my amendments in this group. Thank you, Convener.
Thank you very much, Minister. No member has indicated that they wish to contribute to the debate in this group. So could I ask Liam Kerr to respond to what he's heard and to wind up and to press or withdraw Amendment 13, Mr. Kerr?
Thank you, Convener. I'll respond very briefly. I can confirm that I do support the Minister's amendments, which I think are good and which she'll concede are called for as well. So I'm happy to see that going in. I think the Minister has spoken persuasively, and I'm persuaded by her discussion of all my amendments, actually, Amendment 13 and Amendment 25. So I don't intend to press either of those. On Amendments 23 and 24, I really have sat here and listened and thrown the ideas around in my head. And I think the Minister does make a fair argument. So I won't press either of those either. But I'd say to the Minister, I do think that there is something there. And it might be something, if you wouldn't mind speaking to me about before stage three, and perhaps I might bring something else forward, perhaps I won't, but it would be good to talk through if you wouldn't mind. So I don't press Amendment 13 as your first question.
Thank you. So Mr. Kerr intends to withdraw Amendment 13. Does any member object to Amendment 13 being withdrawn? No member objects. So I call Amendments 14, 15 and 16, all in the name of the Minister and previously debated, and I invite the Minister to move Amendments 14, 16 en bloc.
Moved, Convener.
Thank you. Does any member object to a single question being put on Amendments 14 to 16? No member objects. That's good. Thank you. So the question is that Amendments 14 to 16 are agreed. Are we all agreed? We are agreed. The question is that Section 21 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? We are agreed. I call Amendments 17, 18 and 19, all in the name of the Minister and all previously debated. I invite the Minister to move Amendments 17 to 19 en bloc.
Moved en bloc.
Thank you. Does any member object to a single question being put on Amendments 17 to 19? No member objects. So the question is that Amendments 17 to 19 are agreed to. Are we all agreed? We are agreed. The question is that Section 22 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? We are agreed. I call Amendments 20, 21 and 22, all in the name of the Minister and all previously debated. I invite the Minister to move Amendments 20 to 22 en bloc.
Moved en bloc.
Thank you. Does any member object to a single question being put on Amendments 20 to 22? No member objects. So the question is that Amendments 20 to 22 are agreed to. Are we all agreed? We are agreed. The question is that Section 23 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? We are agreed. I call Amendment 23 in the name of Liam Kerr, already debated with Amendment 13. Liam Kerr, to move or not move?
Not moved.
That's not moved. I call Amendment 24 in the name of Liam Kerr, already debated with Amendment 13. Liam Kerr, to move or not move?
Not moved.
That's not moved. Thank you, Mr. Kerr. The question is that Section 24 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? We are agreed. The question is that Sections 25 and 26 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? We are agreed. I call Amendment 25 in the name of Liam Kerr, already debated with Amendment 13. Mr. Kerr, to move or not move?
Not moved.
That's not moved. So the question is that Sections 27 to 29 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? We are agreed. And we move to our penultimate group, which is concerned with powers of court in relation to a statement. I call Amendment 38 in the name of Fulton McGregor in a group of its own. Fulton McGregor, to move and speak to Amendment 38. Mr. McGregor.
Yeah, thank you, Convener. The aim of this amendment is to achieve a proportionate balance between the protection of reputation, the right to freedom of expression, and the power of the court to make orders to the operator of a website in the early stages of defamation proceedings. Section 13 of the bill, as it was introduced to the committee, would allow a court to order the operator of a website to remove the statement which is the subject of a complaint. Where a court has had the chance to consider the argument from both sides and come to a full conclusion, the order to remove a statement that has been found to be defamatory is an entirely reasonable one, and I think that the committee accepts that. However, in the explanatory notes of the bill, it is explained that this power is not confined to circumstances in which the final outcome of the proceedings has already been determined by the court. Accordingly, the court would be entitled, in an appropriate case, to grant an order for removal or cessation of distribution on an interim basis before the final outcome of the proceedings is known. In our evidence sessions, concerns about this power were raised by media groups, including the Society of Authors, Scottish Pen, the BBC and the Ferret, civil society, legal academics and organisations like the Open Rights Group, the latter of which I would like to thank for their input on this amendment. And given these concerns, I think it is important to consider whether an alternative measure strikes a more proportionate balance. It is in seeking a proportionate balance in these early stages of a defamation dispute in the court system that this amendment proposes to amend the court's power to remove the statement and replace it with a court power to order the website operator to state in a prominent location on the website that the statement is subject to such proceedings. And I should make it clear, Convener, that this amendment seeks to leave intact the power of the court to order the operator by interdict to remove the statement at the end of proceedings. It's focused primarily on when the proceedings are ongoing that this power would be appropriate to be exercised. Additionally, and this might be obvious, but I would like to point out that nothing in this amendment prevents the website operator from removing the statement that's been complained of themselves of their own free will, which they're obviously entitled to do throughout any potential defamation dispute. So in practice, in such a situation, operators would have a choice between removing the statement and leaving it up with the statement that in the prominent position that it's subject to proceedings. And I think committee members can draw their own conclusions about which action operators may choose to take, but it is about that choice being there. In conclusion, I do believe this amendment seeks to introduce those standards, allowing a court to order an appropriate qualification where an action has been initiated into Scottish law. I believe that it meets the policy objectives of the bill to strike an appropriate balance between freedom of expression and protection of reputation, clarifies the law and improves accessibility. All that said, Convener, I'd like to point out at this stage that I have had some preliminary conversations with government, and I'm sure that we can work together on a workable amendment ahead of stage three. So obviously I'm going to hear what the Minister says and if any other members want to speak, but at this point I would say that I'm inclined not to press at this stage, given those conversations. Thanks, Convener.
Thank you very much, Mr. McGregor. No other member has indicated that they wish to support, that they wish to speak in this group. So can I call the Minister to respond, please?
Section 30 of the Bill grants courts a power to order the removal of material which is subject to defamation or Part 2 proceedings from any website on which it appears, and it's intended to provide for the fact that it may not always be possible for the author of material which is the subject of proceedings under the Bill to prevent further distribution of the material or orchestrate its removal. So under the laws that currently stand, Scottish courts do not have similar powers to those conferred on courts in England and Wales by the Defamation Act of 2013. So as far as Amendment 38 is concerned, I do not see any reason why a court should not have the power to either remove material hosted on a website or append a notice to it. And I understand there are concerns about free speech about removing material altogether, but courts would have to consider granting the remedy only where it's justified, and in doing so would have to balance the rights of freedom of expression and protection of reputation. In relevant circumstances, I think this is a useful remedy that can help restore a person's unfairly damaged reputation. Equally, it'd be useful to have on the face of the bill that the court could, where the balance might favour freedom of expression, append the statement complained of, as a notice of this amendment would do. So I'd ask that, I think the member's already said that he's minded not to press, and I think I'd be more than happy to work with him ahead of stage three to get to an amendment which reflects the principles behind what the member is seeking to achieve here.
Thank you, Minister. Could I invite Fulton McGregor to respond and to wind up and to press or withdraw? Mr. McGregor.
Thanks, Convener. Based on my concluding remarks and my own input earlier and what the Minister has said there, I am happy not to press at this stage and work with the Minister ahead of stage three proceedings. So not to press.
Thank you very much, Fulton. So Mr. McGregor seeks to withdraw Amendment 38. Are members content that the amendment be withdrawn? Members are content. Thank you. So the question is that Section 30 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? We are agreed. The question is that Section 31 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? Excellent. Thank you. We are agreed. So we reach our final group on limitation. And I call Amendment 26 in the name of Liam Kerr, grouped with Amendment 27. Mr. Kerr to move Amendment 26 and speak to both amendments. Mr. Kerr.
Thank you, Convener. I'll be brief. Amendments 26 and 27 concern limitation periods, which members will again recall me exploring during the evidence taking. Personally, I'm still not completely persuaded on the one-year limitation point, but I can see all sides of the debate on this one, so I won't be seeking to amend the one-year limitation. There is, however, a general power to override time limits contained under Section 19A of the Prescription and Limitation Scotland Act of 1973, but that doesn't specifically refer to defamation actions in the same way as the English provision at Section 32A of the Limitation Act 1984. Therefore, arguably, I think there's a weaker protection for claimants who would have been automatically entitled to bring a case under the current three-year period. Now, I think that there is merit in amending Section 18A of the 1973 Prescription and Limitation Act to make clear that over and above what is provided for in Section 19A, the court has the power to allow an action to continue beyond the expiry of the one-year period. And I'm not sure that I'd see a reason not to do this, simply for clarity. And so I'd be pleased to have the committee's support on this. Now, separately, in relation to my Amendment 27, members will recall that Section 33 currently makes provision for mediation, which is helpful. So a pause in the limitation period. Several witnesses that we heard from felt this ought to be extended to other forms of dispute resolution, such as arbitration, expert determination, and perhaps press complaints or ombudsman bodies, and I've drafted accordingly. Now, in the Minister's response to me earlier on that I mentioned, she suggests that as expert determination, this is most useful in technological cases, where the technical specification does not meet agreed upon standards. It is highly unlikely that this form of ADR would be utilised in cases of defamation or malicious publication, and therefore I don't think it's appropriate to include this in the bill. And that may be, but if something is highly unlikely to be utilised, it is nevertheless possible that it would be utilised. Accordingly, let's have precision about when limitation would be paused. My amendment offers that precision. Now, I considered including this amendment in the existing section on mediation, but given that that section has been added separately from an existing section on arbitration, there seems to be a logic in keeping that separate too. And for all those reasons, I think I would like to move these amendments, but I'd like to hear particularly the Minister's thoughts on them. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Liam. No member has indicated that they wish to contribute to the debate on this group, so can I ask the Minister to respond, please, Minister?
Thank you. So Section 19A of the Prescription and Limitation Scotland Act of 1973 outlines the equitable discretion of a court to override a time limit. And that section specifically mentions defamation actions by cross-referring to the section that deals with the limitation of defamation actions, which is in Section 18A. So I understand that Mr. Kerr has a concern about the way the 1973 Act compares with a similar act in England and Wales, but I would say to him that no stakeholder brought that up. Limitation and prescription periods for defamation actions form part of the consultation work undertaken by the Scottish Law Commission, and the Scottish Government further consulted on limitation periods after that. And the power of a court to override a time limit was never questioned. As to Amendment 27, I would point out that Section 19CA of the Prescription and Limitation Scotland Act of 1973 provides that any period during which an arbitration is ongoing in relation to a defamation matter is to be disregarded in any computation of the limitation period. So IPSO and IMPRESS, which are the two current press regulated in the UK, deal with complaints by way of arbitration and so would already be caught by the provision in the 1973 Act. And as to expert determination, this is primarily used in tech cases where a technical specification doesn't meet agreed upon standards. However, ADR is an effective means of resolving disputes involving defamation or malicious publication proceedings. I welcome Mr. Kerr's efforts to widen the number of situations in which ADR can be used without unfairly penalising the parties. The Scottish Government would need a little bit more time to consider the drafting of the amendments lodged. However, if Mr. Kerr is willing, I'm sure we could work together to come up with an acceptable draft that avoids any unintended consequences ahead of stage three. So I'd ask the member not to press amendments 26 and 27. Thank you, Convener.
Thank you very much. Minister, could I ask Liam Kerr to respond, wind up, and press or withdraw amendment 26?
very simply and briefly to say, Convener, I'm grateful for the Minister's comments. I would like to do that working together because I do think, again, there's something here. And I look forward to working with her to achieve that. And therefore, I shall press neither Amendment 26 nor Amendment 27.
Thank you, Mr. Kerr. So Mr. Kerr wishes to withdraw Amendment 26. Are members content that Amendment 26 be withdrawn? Members are content. Thank you. The question is that Section 32 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? We are agreed. The question is that Section 33 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? I call Amendment 27 in the name of Liam Kerr, already debated with Amendment 26. Mr. Kerr has indicated that he does not wish to move. That is not moved. I call Amendment 28 in the name of the Minister, already debated with Amendment 9. Minister to move formally?
Moved.
The question is that Amendment 28 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? We are agreed. The question is that Sections 35 to 40 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? We are agreed. And here's my favourite question in the Stage 2 proceeding. The question is that the long title be agreed to. Are we all agreed? We are agreed. That ends Stage 2 consideration of the bill. The bill will now be reprinted as amended at Stage 2 and will be published online at 8:30 tomorrow morning. The Parliament has not yet determined when Stage 3 will be held. Members will be informed of that in due course, along with the deadline for lodging Stage 3 amendments. In the meantime, Stage 3 amendments can be lodged with the clerks in the legislation team. Can I thank the Minister and her officials, and indeed Mr. Whiteman, for joining us this morning. That concludes consideration of Stage 2. We have two further items of public business this morning, so can members please stay online while we move to the next item on our agenda, which is Agenda Item 2, Subordinate Legislation. And we have two negative instruments to consider, colleagues, this morning. Act of Settlement Fees of Messengers at Arms and Sheriff Officers Hague Service Convention Amendment 2020, SSI 2020-43. And Legal Aid and Advice and Assistance Miscellaneous Amendments, Scotland Regulations 2020, which is SSI 2020-424. I refer members to the relevant papers in our pack. Do members have any comments on these SSIs? No member has indicated that they have comments on these SSIs. Are members content not to make any comments to the Parliament on these SSIs? Members are content. That concludes consideration of the SSIs. And the final item on our agenda this morning, colleagues, is a report back on the meeting of the Justice Subcommittee on Policing that took place on the 18th of February. Again, I refer members to the relevant paper in our pack, and I invite comments or questions from members to Mr. Finney, the convener of the subcommittee, if there are any. No member is indicating that they have any comments. Mr. Finney, is there anything that you wish to draw to the committee's attention in addition to what's in the report?
Nothing further to add, thank you, convener. Ongoing matters, of course, are covered and published on the committee's website.
Thank you very much, Mr. Finney. In that case, that concludes our meeting today. Our next meeting will be a week today on Tuesday, the 2nd of February, when we expect to consider the Hate Crime and Public Order Scotland Bill at Stage 2. I now close this meeting and wish everybody a good morning.